Hello, I'm Tony Curtis. Welcome to Hollywood Babylon.
John Belushi had it all. A legendary television series, a blockbuster movie career, an adoring wife. He also had a major problem. He believed he owed his success to a drug dealer. Vivian Leigh lusted after two things in life, Laurence Olivier and the lead role in Gone with the Wind. She got both, and her obsessions also brought her alcoholism and nymphomania. And from the Hollywood file, the homosexual life of Academy Award winner Charles Laughton. John Belushi, life and death in the fast lane. And Vivian Leigh, beware of what you pray for, you just might get it. Next on Hollywood Babylon.
John Belushi, from Killer Bees to the Blues Brothers. He was that fat, crazy guy, a comic genius who brought a new brand of comedy to television on Saturday Night Live. His wild humor came to the big screen in that movie Animal House, and John Belushi rode the rocket of success. The bigger his fame, the bigger Belushi's drug abuse became. The drugs robbed him of a chance to fulfill his dreams, and they would cost him his life.
In 1982, only 7 years after becoming a national star, a fan placed a handwritten sign at John Belushi's grave that said it all. He could have given us a lot more laughs, but no. Tragically, John Belushi believed that his brilliant characterizations were due not so much to his talent, but to the drugs he took. Drugs which he consumed in dangerous and eventually lethal amounts. In 1975, a revolution hit late-night television when the NBC television network premiered Saturday Night Live. Belushi nosed out fellow comedian Bill Murray for the job and was hired along with such comic geniuses as Chevy Chase, Gilda Radner, Dan Aykroyd, Lorraine Newman, Jane Curtin, and Garrett Morris as part of the original cast. Belushi found his early inspirations in LSD, peyote, mescaline, and amphetamines. But cocaine eventually became his drug of choice. And like many of his Saturday Night Live buddies, he snorted it by the yard. But Belushi couldn't stop. And he eventually added heroin to his mania menu. In 1978, Belushi's bizarre alter ego, Pluto Plutarski, a combination of the most outrageous of all his Saturday Night Live characters, belched his way to popularity in the smash hit movie, Animal House. During Saturday Night Live's third season, Belushi and one of his co-stars, Dan Aykroyd, introduced the now famous rock and roll characters, the Blues Brothers. The characters were instant hits. Saturday Night Live had made John Belushi a household name. Although he was making $200,000 a year on the show, he had only contempt for it and its executive producer, Lorne Michaels. The only passion he had was the Blues Brothers. And midway through the fourth season on Saturday Night Live, he decided it would be his last. In 1980, Belushi and Aykroyd reunited the Blues Brothers, but this time on the big screen. It was a blockbuster hit, grossing over $100 million. But instead of savoring the road to success, Belushi was rapidly speeding down the road to self-destruction. His need for drugs appeared to be uncontrollable. And his habit soon took $2,500 a week to to satisfy. Despite his known drug use, in 1982, under a deal with Paramount Studios, he had co-written a screenplay called Noble Rot.
John's asking for more cash. $1,500.
More cash?
The studio hands him pocket change to the tune of $2,500 a week, and it's still not enough?
Yeah, his wife called this morning. Asked us not to give him any more money.
John, you look like hell. When was the last time you slept?
What'd they say about my script?
John, we all think Noble Rot needs some work.
What? They don't know anything about comedy. That character is me. I can make it work. It'll be funny. Those idiots. I'll call them and find out what's going on. Not the hell with it. I want my money. I want to get out of here.
The rejection of Noble Rot affected Belushi much harder than anyone realized. Ultimately, it would lead to Belushi's death. John Belushi was a person who always needed immediate approval. The rejection of his script, Noble Rot, by Paramount set him off on a 5-day binge of drugs and alcohol.
They don't want me.
Calm down, do another line.
No, I'm sick of coke. Where's your friend?
She'll be here, just relax.
The woman they were waiting for was Kathy Smith, who had built up her local Hollywood drug connections during the 8 months she lived with the Rolling Stones before they tossed her out for talking back to Mick Jagger. She was broke, having used up all her drug profits on her own habit, and drifted aimlessly around Hollywood for almost a year. She had even been banned from several of the Sunset Strip clubs for being an obnoxious drunk. But Kathy still had her connections.
I want to mix a heroin and coke.
Into speedballs, aren't you?
Nah, I hate needles. You do it.
Because Belushi had a fear of needles, he was afraid of injecting himself. So Smith accommodated him, injecting Belushi at least a dozen more times. Smith was at Belushi's side during his entire 5-day binge. Among other things, he had Smith get him a gram of pure heroin to use with his cocaine. Along with friends of Belushi's, they would party till the local clubs on Hollywood Sunset Strip closed. Then returned to John's $200 a day bungalow at Hollywood's exclusive Chateau Marmont Hotel for more action. Smith said Belushi tried anything he could find, and her connections were good enough to keep his voracious drug appetite fed. Belushi's final night was just another leg of his never-ending drug marathon.
Give him the money. Come on.
Just before 2 a.m. on March 5th, Belushi scored his third package of cocaine for the night. Among the friends he partied with that night were actors Robert De Niro and Robin Williams. The rumor was that they both returned with Belushi to the Chateau Marmont, but this was never proven. By 3:30 that morning, Belushi and Smith were alone. He was still doing speedballs, snorting cocaine, and drinking wine from cases he had shipped to his bungalow. According to Smith, around 6 a.m., Belushi began having hot and cold flashes.
It's cold in here. Turn the heat up.
You get any more of that stuff? Use what's on the table. Mix it with heroin.
By 9:30 the next morning, Smith, alarmed at the way Belushi was breathing, woke him up. Belushi begged her not to leave him alone. Instead, Smith took the syringe and the spoon they had been using and left Belushi alone in the bungalow. At noon, Belushi was found in the bungalow, laying face down on the bedroom floor, dead. While his millions of fans still wonder how someone as young and talented as John Belushi could have wasted his life on drugs and alcohol, Kathy Smith summed it up briefly when she remarked, "It was just the Hollywood scene, really. Nothing out of the ordinary."
Belushi's death was attributed to an acute heroin and cocaine intoxication. Kathy Smith, who gave John his dope, was charged with Belushi's murder, but plea bargained to a lesser charge of manslaughter. After serving half of a 3-year sentence, she was released and deported to her native Canada, where she was again busted on heroin charges. In Bob Woodward's book, Wired, An Investigation of Belushi's Death, Woodward wrote, "He used to make us laugh. Now he can make us think."
And now another story from inside the Hollywood file. In many ways, Charles Laughton's Oscar-winning performance in The Private Life of Henry VIII was a mirror image of his own life. In the film, Laughton plays the lusty king who devours women and food with equal relish. The movie even co-stars Laughton's real-life wife, Elsa Lanchester. Like Henry, Laughton was a lover of good food, music, and wine. And just like the king, Laughton had his own dark private life. Laughton and King Henry were both sexual compulsives, but where Henry's taste ran to bawdy wenches, Charles' obsession was for slim young men. Despite his strange sexual orientation, Laughton remained happily married to Elsa for his entire life, and an extraordinary life it was. In the second year of their marriage, Charles returned to their London home one evening to find the police waiting for him. A young boy had told authorities that Laughton had picked him up in the park and taken him home. Though nothing came of the boy's accusation, Charles broke down and told Elsa everything. Instead of collapsing in tears or demanding a divorce, she simply said, "It's perfectly all right. It doesn't matter. I understand." They remained married for 32 more years. Elsa would satisfy her sexual needs with young men, and so would Charles. But they always returned to each other for intellectual and spiritual companionship. For that, they were well matched. Laughton was a brilliant performer with an astonishing range. He played the hunchback of Notre Dame and cosmopolitan inspector Maigret. He played sadists and kindly ghosts, murderers, and senators. Elsa Lanchester was also remarkably versatile, starring in frothy comedies such as Pajama Game and the she-monster in Bride of Frankenstein. She also co-starred with Charles in many notable films such as The Private Life, Tales of Manhattan, and Witness for the Prosecution, for which they both received Academy Award nominations. But at night, they went their separate ways. When Laughton was filming Mutiny on the Bounty, the studio hired a muscular young masseuse named Dennis to help the star relax. Dennis became Charles' first nearly open romance. When Laughton's co-star, Clark Gable, frequently accused Charles of upstaging him, touching off furious shouting matches, it was Dennis who would take Charles for long walks, soothing him as one would gentle an angry horse. Then, Laughton met Bruce, a handsome young British fashion model. Laughton fell deeply in love with Bruce, seeing in him the perfect English son he and Elsa never had. And of course, Laughton was obsessed with Bruce's physical beauty, a quality he himself so lacked. Laughton stayed with Bruce and Elsa until he died of cancer. The eulogy at Charles' funeral was taken from Shakespeare's play, The Tempest, in which Laughton and Elsa had once co-starred. The play ends with this plea: "As you from crimes would pardoned be, let your indulgence set me free."
She was gone with the wind, Scarlett O'Hara. Gifted, vivacious, married to Larry Olivier, one of the most beautiful actresses of her time. but Vivian Lee's mental illness and alcoholism led to bizarre behavior. As her marriage with Olivier crumbled, she cruised the streets at night. From the heights of happiness and renown, Vivian Lee descended into her own private hell.
Vivian Lee was a woman who knew what she wanted and got it. While still married to her first husband, she told a friend that someday she was going to marry Laurence Olivier. In 1934, a determined Vivian convinced the producer of the movie Fire Over England to cast her as Olivier's co-star. A passion ignited in both of them. Though married to other spouses, they began living together, and both asked for divorces. When Olivier came to America in 1938 to make the film classic Wuthering Heights, Vivian quickly followed. She said it was loneliness for Olivier, but her real motive was to arrange a meeting for herself with the famous movie producer David O. Selznick, who was then producing the movie epic Gone with the Wind. Vivian was determined to be Scarlett O'Hara. She even read Margaret Mitchell's novel five times and several volumes of Civil War history to prepare for the role. Vivian used Olivier to arrange a dinner with Selznick's brother, Myron, a famous Hollywood agent. And shortly after that dinner, Vivian got the screen test that she wanted. On January 13, 1939, when the long-awaited casting announcement was made, Vivian Lee was cast as Scarlett O'Hara. The public was outraged. How was an English woman going to play Scarlett O'Hara? But that was of no concern to producer Selznick, who was more worried about her off-screen romance to Olivier. He told the amorous couple that until they were married, they were not to live together or have any public displays of affection.
Oh, it's you.
Afternoon, ma'am. I've come to read your meter.
That's fine. I was just expecting... It's out back. I'll show you. Waiting for you all day. I was beginning to give up.
I love you and only you.
And I love you.
Vivian showed upper critics with an Oscar-winning performance in Gone with the Wind. During the film's gala opening in Atlanta, Southerners actually embraced her as one of their own.
Ladies and gentlemen, I've spent quite a good deal of my time on Peachtree Street this year. And now that I'm here, it feels... was just as if I were coming home. And the warmth and kindness of your wonderful welcome has made it the happiest homecoming I could possibly imagine.
Vivian and Olivier were finally free to marry in 1940. She was totally devoted to Olivier.
You know I love you more than anything in the world. You're my father, my brother, and my son. All these things.
But Olivier was totally devoted to his career. He became jealous that Vivian was more sought after by the Hollywood movie makers. To keep him happy, Vivian concentrated her time on Olivier's first love, the theater. Under Olivier's influence, the woman who had taken Hollywood by storm in Gone with the Wind would only make 9 movies in her career. In 1952, Vivian Lee took her brilliant stage performance of Blanche DuBois in A Streetcar Named Desire to the big screen, playing opposite Marlon Brando.
Let's have a little fuss.
There were many similarities between Vivian and Blanche. Vivian had known for years that Olivier was having a homosexual relationship with actor Danny Kaye. And after the filming, Vivian had difficulty separating the character of Blanche from her real life. Vivian began drinking and experiencing wild mood swings. She would go from amphetamine-like highs of uncontrollable hyperactivity to extremes of irritability accompanied by screaming temper tantrums. After these incidents would pass, Vivian would return to normal, remembering nothing about them. Vivian finally lost total control during the filming of the movie Elephant Walk, in which she co-starred with Olivier's close friend, Peter Finch. While on location in Ceylon, Vivian and Finch became very close drinking buddies and lovers. The drinking accelerated her mood swings.
What's going on here? Why aren't you shooting? Why is everyone just standing around?
Nothing's wrong, Irving, darling. Dieterle's just being terribly temperamental. He hasn't gotten over losing the war.
I can't shoot her like that. The wig is on wrong.
Vivian, everyone is waiting. Let's get the hairdresser to fix your wig, and then we can get on with the shooting.
This is the way I'm wearing it, dammit!
It won't match any of the footage we've already shot, Vivian. Dieterle can't shoot you with your wig like that.
Well, he doesn't have to look at me.
Olivier was urged to go to Ceylon to help with Vivian, and during his visit, she returned to normal. But when the production moved back to Hollywood, Peter Finch broke off their affair. Vivian went into a severe state of depression. Filming was suspended for several weeks to allow Vivian to recover. What no one knew was that Vivian was a manic depressive, an illness which results in erratic mood swings and often leads to a compulsion for alcohol and even nymphomania. She would often go to the seedier part of town looking for sex. The rougher, the better. Vivian was eventually replaced on Elephant Walk by a young actress named Elizabeth Taylor. The studio thought Vivian and Taylor looked enough alike that they could keep Vivian's long shots and use Taylor for only the close-ups. Vivian returned to England with Olivier, where she was immediately hospitalized for 3 months. During her hospitalization, doctors finally diagnosed her as a manic depressive and began treating her with electroshock therapy. The shock therapy helped temporarily to stabilize her condition, but Vivian struggled with the disease throughout the rest of her life and was forced to endure many more sessions of electroshock. Doctors would ultimately find that she was clinically schizophrenic. Her illness was the final blow to her marriage to Olivier. Unable to cope with Vivian and his guilt, Olivier divorced her in 1960.
Towards the end of her life, Vivian Lee took to calling herself Lady Olivier. She kept a photograph of Sir Larry beside her bed and constantly reread his letters. Vivian Lee died of tuberculosis at the age of 53. When he heard of her death, Olivier was ill and in the hospital. He went straight to her apartment, knelt down, and prayed for her.
In 1982, John Hinckley Jr. wrote to a correspondent from his mental institution that he planned to escape, hijack a plane, and kill Jodie Foster. We'll be right back with more Hollywood Babylon.
Have you got a minute?
Good.
I was driving to Carbon Beach in Malibu. My second-hand blue Riviera convertible with Dynaflow drive and the top down. I stopped. Then I noticed a film company shooting down at the beach, so I moseyed on down and stopped about 50 feet from where everyone was working. I couldn't get enough of the experience of making a movie. I'd done two bits by then, and I felt like a veteran. Out of everything that looked like chaos, there was a procedure that went unnoticed. When the actors weren't working, the crew was, setting up for a shot. The director was standing on the outskirts of the company, waiting for them to get ready. I didn't recognize the actors. And the director caught sight of me, and he kept looking at me every now and then. He finally came up to me and asked me if I could swim. I said, yeah. He said, would you like to pick up 20 bucks? All you got to do is come out of the ocean and come up the beach while the actors in the foreground are playing that scene. I said, okay, but I don't have a suit. He said, wardrobe will get you one. Well, there I was, suited up and in the surf. When the director waved at me, that was my cue to come out of the water, and I did. I did it at least 35 times from different angles. I was cold and wet. But I was in the movies and flirting with a beautiful makeup girl named Diana from the Valley with and very long legs. And that night, with that 20 I made that day, I took Diana to Barney's Beanery for dinner. She was the first girl I had dated since I'd come to California. I was a lucky dude. She turned out to be the niece of the head of Columbia Pictures, Harry Cohn. California, here I come. Hello, I'm Tony Curtis. Welcome to Hollywood Babylon.
Beatle John Lennon. He wrote songs about peace, but for a time, lived a life of violence. He and Yoko Ono were rock and roll's radical couple. The Beatles split up shortly after their marriage. One day, Yoko picked out a mistress for John, and he went on his own revolution. Errol Flynn, swashbuckling star of Hollywood's epic adventure films of the 1930s. His lust for young girls got him into trouble, and a trial for statutory rape became his biggest battle of all. And from the Hollywood file, the bizarre life of Peter Lawford, movie star, drug addict, and brother-in-law of the President of the United States. John Lennon, and the wife who played mind games. Errol Flynn, and the two teenagers who made him pay for his passion. Next on Hollywood Babylon.
John Lennon was a thinking man's Beatle, a rock and roll rebel with a message. But when he came under the spell of avant-garde would-be artist Yoko Ono, he gave up his independence and submitted to Yoko's dominant will. By 1972, with their marriage failing, Yoko arranged for her temporary replacement, a beautiful Asian girl named May Pang, the Lennon's 20-year-old personal assistant. But something happened that Yoko could not predict. John and May fell in love.
By the time the Beatles invaded the United States in 1963, the British rock group was number one on the charts and on top of the music world. John, Paul, George, and Ringo were the biggest thing since Elvis.
So there you have the homecoming of the Beatles, the return of the heroes to their native land. They did what the Redcoats couldn't do in the American Revolution. They conquered the colonies.
Some people thought the hysteria over the Beatles was just a passing fad, but soon realized they represented an important sign of the changing times. No one realized the Beatles would be the start of a social revolution. The music, written mostly by John Lennon and Paul McCartney, mirrored the disillusionment of a generation, influencing fans all over the world. The Beatles were here to stay. At early Beatles performances, fans fainted in record numbers. But by the mid-60s, the Beatles' music had awakened a growing dissatisfaction with the political and social climate in the younger generation. It was, the Beatles urged, time to give peace a chance. As the counterculture drifted into drugs, Lennon led the parade. It was during this time that he met Yoko Ono, a struggling avant-garde artist. She pursued him relentlessly, hoping he would finance her career. They began a relationship and finally married in 1969. It was a time of long hair and granny glasses, acid tripping and primal screaming. John and Yoko tried it all. They made music and headlines, staged protests and bed-ins, and became rock and roll's most radical couple. Yoko pulled John away from the mainstream and the Beatles. The group broke up in 1970. John and Yoko moved to New York, and by the mid-70s, their marriage was in trouble. They were considering sex therapy at a clinic when Yoko came up with a different solution to their problems. May Pang, their 20-year-old assistant, would become John's mistress. She was naive and could be controlled. The arrangement would resemble the one Yoko's own father had when she was growing up in Japan, where wives and mistresses often remain friends.
A few nights ago, John and I went to a party. John got drunk, very drunk. He went into a bedroom with some girl while I was in the other room. Everybody knew. May, I know he likes you a lot. I think you should get together with him.
I can't do it, Yoko.
Why not?
He's your husband. I work for you, for both of you. I can't do it.
I went through primal therapy with John. I've seen him go back to his childhood. I know how to handle his deepest fears. I want you to look after his deepest needs.
The young Chinese girl was appalled at Yoko's suggestion, but was afraid to disagree with the powerful woman who had completely taken control of John Lennon's life. Yoko urged May to begin the affair that night at a recording session. She had obviously already discussed the idea with John and gotten his eager consent.
I've been wanting to do this all bleeding day.
Yoko's been putting ideas in your head.
I've fancied you for a long time. You got beautiful skin. You got these almond eyes. But nobody can get close to you.
I'm too busy. I've got too many things to do.
Don't you want me?
I don't know. You can have any girl, John. This is too confusing.
This is just as confusing to me as it is to you.
May Pang was no match for the needy rock star.
You're my first Chinese girl.
In Chinese, my name is Feng Yi. It means phoenix bird.
Feng Yi. You're so beautiful.
And while John Lennon was recording the album Mind Games, it became clear that his wife had played some of her own and won. John Lennon went to Hollywood to record an album shortly after the affair with May began. Yoko suggested that he take May along, but insisted that in public, she should be his private secretary. Their affair was to remain a secret. Mother, John's nickname for Yoko, called constantly to remind them of her orders.
Yes, Yoko, I'll tell her. We'll do it your way.
That must be the 17th call today. Is everything all right?
Mother's afraid the papers will find out we separated. She's worried about her image. If they ask her, she's going to say she's kicked me out because I've been a bad boy.
Yoko was determined to maintain her cherished reputation as the first lady of rock and roll. And she was convinced that she could control John and May. Yoko had manipulated her husband for so long that she couldn't imagine a time when he would not obey her. But John relished his new freedom and became the child away from mother with a new playmate. Yoko's plan was beginning to backfire.
I love you, Feng Yi. I'm going to tell Mother that we'll do what she wants. Then we'll do what we want. It's the only way to keep the peace.
John Lennon hit the streets of Hollywood with a vengeance. He and May became regulars on the Sunset Strip nightclub scene. Night after night became a continual blur of drugs and alcohol. One night, after a number of Brandy Alexanders, which John called milkshakes, he defied Mother's orders.
You know, I love you.
Oh,
who is she? What's her name?
John.
John, everybody's coming.
I don't care.
Who is she? What's her name? What's she called, John?
With that acknowledgement, the private affair became a public scandal. John suddenly realized that Yoko would soon learn that he had disobeyed her. He became enraged and began directing his anger at anyone in his path. Photographers, reporters, and friends all became the object of his wrath. And these incidents made headlines all over the world. His victims eventually included May Pang.
Ma'am, I've had a complaint.
We just had too much to drink. Sorry.
Hey, you're John Lennon. Tell me something, are you gonna get back together with the Beatles?
Finally, the one person who could control John Lennon did. Yoko Ono ordered John to come home. She had tired of her life alone, outside of the spotlight, without her famous husband. The affair she had orchestrated ended after 18 months, and John returned to New York and Mother. Shortly afterwards, they had a child of their own. John Lennon was murdered a few years later at the age of 40. He left an estate of $235 million and a rich legacy of words and music. He had once asked his fans to come together over me. And at the end of his life, they did. A candlelight vigil was held simultaneously in cities around the world. John Lennon had imagined a world where there's nothing left to kill or die for. He just hadn't lived in one.
John Lennon was assassinated on December 7th, 1980, by a born-again fanatic named Mark David Chapman, a loser whose only purpose was to gain notoriety. Yoko Ono inherited half of Lennon's estate and initiated a press campaign to boost record sales after John's death. As for May Pang, she was left only with her memories and the ultimate gift, a song, Surprise, Surprise, from the Walls and Bridges album that John had dedicated to her.
And now another story from inside the Hollywood vile. Peter Lawford's life was filled with controversy from the beginning. His father, General Sir Sidney Lawford, one of the most highly decorated British soldiers of World War I, was knighted in the field. A handsome, regal leader, he was referred to by his men as Swanky Sid. His world was one of power, influence, and high position. And he loved being in the company of beautiful women. The general's affairs with women were always discreet until he caused his colonel's wife, May Allen, to become pregnant. Distraught over the news, the colonel summoned his wife to his office, where, in full military dress, he blew his head off with a shotgun. The trauma of her illicit love affair and her insistence that Peter be born at home affected May the rest of her life. Though she eventually married the general and legally changed Peter's name to Lawford, the shock may have started her deterioration into a permanent state of severe mental illness. Peter Lawford first came into the Hollywood limelight when MGM Studios made him a movie star in the 1940s. From that time on, the controversy in his life accelerated. He was often linked with the alleged murder of Marilyn Monroe, the Kennedy White House, and the era of burned-out drug-abusing movie stars. Though natural good looks and luck brought him a successful career in the movies, it was the influence of his wealthy father-in-law, Joseph P. Kennedy, that allegedly brought him a career in television. Unfortunately, with it came massive insecurity, self-doubt, and dependence on drugs and alcohol, four wives, huge debts, and deep emotional pain. By the 1950s, Lawford had become best friends with Frank Sinatra, Sammy Davis Jr., and Dean Martin. Known as the Klan, they set the standard for the cool, easygoing lifestyle filled with sex and booze and totally void of responsibility. John F. Kennedy was often seen in their company. His love for being in the presence of major show business personalities was well known publicly. Lawford and his brother-in-law, JFK, rapidly became good friends, but Peter's lifestyle began to take its toll on his health and wealth. By the 1970s, he had been divorced three times, was on the verge of being an alcoholic, was heavily into drugs, and was almost broke. In December 1983, Lawford followed the path of many other celebrities and checked into the Betty Ford Center to detoxify from drug and alcohol abuse. On Christmas Eve, December 24th, 1984, Peter Lawford died of cardiac arrest at the age of 61. His body was cremated and his ashes were buried in a vault at Hollywood's famous Westwood Memorial Park, the same cemetery in which Marilyn Monroe is buried. But in May 1988, the bankrupt Lawford estate still owed $10,000 in unpaid funeral bills. His widow, Patricia Lawford, was forced to remove his ashes from the cemetery. In the end, Peter Lawford's remains were scattered at sea from a boat hired by a group of reporters who went along for the ride.
Errol Flynn was one of Hollywood's handsomest superstars, a man with a reputation as a great lover, both on and off the screen, as a swashbuckler, as a fencer. He was often cast in roles defending the honor of lovely young virgins. Off screen, that's what he wanted. Flynn worked hard at living up to his image, and his flamboyant lifestyle often got him into serious trouble.
On screen, Errol Flynn was larger than life. He was the hero of Hollywood's action films of the 1930s, sweeping tales of historical romance. This fearless swashbuckler always won his battles.
I'm thief and pirate, and I'll show you how a thief and a pirate can deal.
And in true Hollywood tradition, he always got the girl.
What matters is that now I own you as once you owned me. You're mine, you understand? Mine to do with as I please.
His starring role in the 1935 movie Captain Blood skyrocketed the Australian native to immediate stardom and made him a major player on the Hollywood social scene. His conquests in real life rivaled his successes at the box office. Errol Flynn became the golden boy of the silver screen and the bad boy of Hollywood. By the early 1940s, life in the fast lane finally caught up with Flynn. Though married, the well-known screen star was charged with statutory rape, sex with a minor, by two different teenagers. Though the incidents were unrelated and the girls did not know one another, the court decided to try both cases at the same time. 17-year-old Betty Hansen accused Flynn of forcing her to have sex with him after she became ill at a dinner party.
What did he do at the dinner party when you said you weren't feeling well?
He took me upstairs and told me he was going to lie me down.
And?
We went upstairs.
Then what did he do?
He sat me down and told me he was going to put me to bed.
What did you think was going to happen? Just going to take a nap?
Yes, sir.
Then what happened?
He started to take off all his clothes, except his shoes. And then he started to undress me.
You said that he removes your slacks. Didn't you want him to remove them?
I didn't have no objections.
Then what happened?
he got on top of me.
Was he undressed too?
Uh-huh. Yes, except for the shoes.
Did you respond to him?
I guess I did.
You didn't scream or shout?
Well, maybe a little.
Flynn's lawyer destroyed Betty's testimony, also attacking the credibility of Peggy Satterley, the second girl who accused Flynn of seducing her during a weekend cruise on his yacht when she was just 15.
Was there anything special about the sky that night on the ocean?
Oh, yes, the moon. I said that the moon was beautiful.
And what did Mr. Flynn say?
He said that it would be more beautiful through a porthole.
And then what happened?
Then he went down into the cabin.
Did you follow him in?
Yeah.
Why?
Because I wanted to see the moon through a porthole.
Look, darling, through the porthole, can you see the glorious moon?
Oh. Who cares about the stupid moon?
And was the moon more beautiful through the porthole?
I didn't really look.
While the jury deliberated his fate, Flynn lived up to his reputation. On his way out of the courtroom, he flirted with a teenager at the candy stand.
Sorry. Mr. Flynn.
Yes, could I have a pack of Luckies, please? Tell me, are you lucky?
That depends on what you're looking for.
The next day's headlines told the story. After 13 hours of deliberation, the 9-woman, 3-man jury acquitted Flynn of all charges. Flynn heralded his innocence as a victory for the American justice system. He immediately celebrated at a party given in his honor. As a joke, the invitations requested that guests bring birth certificates to prove they were over 18. There were lots of good-natured jokes at Flynn's expense.
I'll be 18 next week. I am not even going to walk down the other side of the street with anyone under the age of 18 again.
But Flynn's promise proved difficult for him to keep. And his lust for young women continued throughout his life.
At least I know you're over the age of 18.
Almost. Kidding, just kidding.
By the end of that year, Flynn had eloped with Nora Eddington, the 18-year-old girl who worked at the candy counter in the courthouse during the trial. Errol Flynn's life story rivals any Hollywood script. The flamboyant star left Hollywood in the 1950s a broken and bankrupt man. He returned 4 years later to attempt a comeback. Flynn was just beginning to work again when his luck and time ran out. He died of a heart attack. At the time of his death, he was in love with a 15-year-old actress.
The dazzling charm of this highly visible screen Casanova actually masked a deep sense of insecurity. The Hollywood lifestyle ultimately drove Flynn to drink. Towards the end of his career, he fell back on tongue-in-cheek parodies of his earlier swashbuckling roles. Errol Flynn died in 1959. He was just 50 years old.
Mickey Rourke supported himself with a series of odd jobs before making it big in the movies. He was at one time an attack dog agitator, a good humor man, and a towel boy in a bathhouse.
You got a minute? In the summer of 48, New York to L.A. was a traumatic experience for me. One of the first things I did was to buy a convertible and learn how to drive. Not necessarily in that order. There was a used car dealer called Sailor Jack's. I bought this dark green Chevy convertible, circa 1935, for $212. With the mileage stuck at 183,000 miles, Sailor Jack told me it was cherry. Well, being from New York, I believed him. About a week later, I was teaching myself to drive on the back lot. I had the top down, showing off me and my car to all the girls who were on the contract. A horse wrangler was out there teaching him to ride. My foot slipped off the clutch and I slammed into the barn. With hay flying, I came to an abrupt stop. The girls laughed and the wise-ass wrangler smiled at me and said, "You want a horse? Only if it's got automatic transmission." This is Tony Curtis. Thanks for watching. See you next time on Hollywood Babylon.